The C is for the courage I possess through the drama. H is for the hurt, but it's all for the honor. A is for my attitude, working through the patience. Money comes and goes, so the M is for motivation. Gotta stay consistent, the P is to persevere. The I is for integrity, innovative career. The O is optimistic, open and never shut. And the N is necessary, cause I'm never giving up. See, they ask me how I did it, I just did it from the heart. Crushing the competition, been doing it from the start. They say that every champion is all about his principles. Carry.
I am invincible, unbreakable, unstoppable, unshakable. They knock me down, I get up again. I am the champion. You're gonna know my name. You can't hurt me now, I can't feel the pain. I was made for this, yeah, I was born to win. I am the champion.
Welcome to another episode of The Making of Champions. I'm your host, Coach Tyree Price, and today's guest is known throughout Division I, Division II level. Coach Wes Kittley, Texas Tech Director of Track and Field and Cross Country, created history on June 7th, 2019, when his Red Raiders claimed the first NCAA championship in history of the men's athletics at Texas Tech. And for that feat, he was named USTFCCCA Men's Coach of the Year, a first for a Texas Tech coach. At Texas Tech, Coach Kittley has produced one national championship, 28 NCAA champions, and 257 first-team All-Americans. He came to Texas Tech after leading one of the most successful programs in the history of collegiate track and field at Abilene Christian University. While Abilene Christian University, Kittley won an unprecedented 29 national championships in track and field. And there, Coach Kittley won his first national championship in 1985 when he, on the women's side, when the Wildcats squad won a Division II outdoor championship, a title he will win again in 86, 87, and 88. When ACU combined their programs in 1993, Coach Kittley was selected as the men's head coach, and he wasted no time in flaunting the men's program to an elite level by winning the Division II indoor national title in his first season. Please welcome Coach Wes Kittley. Thank you.
Thank you, Tyree. It's good to be with you. I appreciate all that. You're dating me a little bit when you start getting back in those 80s now. But I appreciate the opportunity. I'm really humbled to be here and to have an opportunity to hopefully help somebody along the way.
Great. Well, let's get started here. When you have been a part of a championship pedigree for some time now, I want to focus on your squads, both at Abilene Christian and Texas Tech. You were one of the very few to win a national championship at both the Division II and the Division I level. So, you know, that's kind of precedent right there. In order to do this, you had to assemble a great staff at both places. What were your thoughts when it came to assembling the staff both at Abilene and Texas Tech? And how important is it to have that staff to develop a championship program?
Well, it's first of all, you know, at Abilene Christian, of course, we were Division II. And at Texas Tech, we were Division I. In the 80s, man, you probably didn't know, but we didn't have a lot of money. And when I got the women's coach head position, I had just finished running for Abilene Christian myself on the men's side. I'd stayed around and volunteered for 1 year. And then Coach Hood was the head men's coach, but the AD walked down and offered me the women. And yeah, I was 23 years old. But I had come out of national championship programs being there on the men's side. And I think the greatest thing that helped me, no doubt, my staff was just incredible. I didn't have much money, but one thing I've always tried to do, and I feel like when people just tell me they can't do something, I mean, I literally had $3,000 or $4,000 per assistant. But what I wound up doing was finding jobs for them on campus, and we just made it work. But other than being poor and not having anything, we smelled good, looked good. I called it smoke and mirrors, but we had a great group of people. And I tried to find coaches that loved, you know, I was in Abilene. I'm a West Texas guy. And, you know, that would fit into a West Texas culture, that would want to come to Abilene, just like wanting to come to Texas Tech. And that was important to me. But I wanted to have one vision, and I wanted to get people to know my vision. And those people that I felt had a humble spirit about them, wanted to learn, weren't trying to come in here and know everything. Those were the people I was looking for. And I picked a bunch of young guys that were eager to learn, that bought into my vision. And then I tried to figure out their strengths. And then I really tried to flourish that. I didn't beat them up too much on the things they didn't know. I really tried to put them in positions of where they were good. And then I kind of filled in myself the other places. The greatest blessing I ever had is when I first started coaching, I had to coach the javelin, the shot, the disc, everything. And it gave me a feel, at least when I got to where I am now, whether you're doing your job or not, because I kind of had to do that. And I think some of us older coaches, it's been in it, this is my 37th year, we all had to start that way. And a lot of y'all didn't, because, you know, it's so specialized now. But I think it really helped me to do that. But to put my young coaches in a good position, have one vision so we don't have any division, and went to work.
Let's go to the other side of it. So when it came to recruiting student athletes in your quest to win championships, what were the key elements that you were in search of in those particular student athletes when it came to building the championship program?
Yeah, it's always I love recruiting. And I think that's been one of the greatest things that we've done at Abilene and that we did here. I go back to that, man, they got to be a good fit. You know, if you don't like West Texas, or you don't like a small town or an agriculture, you know, we get beat up on that my whole 37 years, whether I was at Abilene or I'm here. You know, people talk bad about, you know, being a country bumpkin or whatever, but I just look for people that overlooked all that and look for the quality in each kid. I didn't like a kid that necessarily gone to 3 or 4 high schools. I look at things like that, whether they bounced around a lot. That doesn't mean that things didn't cause that. Maybe jobs, parents had to move. But if they weren't getting along with people like at their school, and then they would just pack up and leave. I can't tell you how many times that I have not picked kids and I would lose them. They'd go somewhere else, but then they wind up leaving there too. And so you kind of look for little things like that, I think, when you're recruiting. Of course, you're always going after the best kid, but it's got to be the best fit. And I want a worker. You know, I'm Division II are my roots, and I didn't always have everything. And I think the key is finding somebody that really wants to get after it. You're made through your daily routine. I always tell my kids that. It's you are what you do day to day. And so I wanted a kid that was work, not spoiled. I loved them being on kind of a winning team because they would know how to win, but I didn't necessarily, you know, not recruit them if they had been on terrible teams in high school or whatever. I just looked more for their character.
Okay. So what do you believe are the key ingredients to building a championship program, i.e. facilities, scholarships, the talent, coaches, administration? What are those key ingredients?
Well, and not to put this on me, I think the number one thing, and I'll really talk about it here at Texas Tech, is to get the right person in for the head coach. I love being at Abilene Christian. I was an Abilene Christian X. I was an All-American. I ran there. I wanted to be there. And then I had to travel to Texas Tech. They had the only indoor. We had an old bubble, we called it, in the old day. And I thought it was great. So, you know, I thought Texas Tech was big time. I was D2 and they were D1. I could always beat them, but I couldn't understand why. I'm like, man, that ought to be a great job. And so, number one, I wanted to be here. And I can't tell you, 22 years later, I'm still here. And I think that's the most important thing. You've got to find people and to sell a vision to. And you sell it to your community. You sell it to your school. You sell it to the administration. And your coaches and your athletes. And I think that's what I came from, a winning culture from Abilene Christian to here. The men were winning national championships when I took the women and started women. So we still could look over on the other side of the track and see what the men were doing. They were setting a good example. And we knew the level, the ceiling that had been set for us to go get it. When I came to Tech, we were dead last in the conference. They had never scored over 15 points hardly at a conference meet. And, man, I just won four national championships, men and women indoor, women, men and women outdoor in 99. So I really got humbled very quickly. But, you know, I was the right person for the job because I loved this play. I love West Texas. I love this community. I didn't listen to my naysayers. And I sold a vision, I think, is the biggest thing you can do.
Okay. Again, you kind of led into my next question here. Is that, well, when you came to Texas Tech, you know, they were not known to be a top 25 program, nevertheless a championship program on the men's side or on the women's side. During the past few seasons, what changed? And did you know going into the fall of 2018 that this was that month of practice that this is the squad that was going to do it?
Yeah, it's a really good question. You know, I want to back up one quick thing. When I came to Texas Tech, as sorry as we were, I thought we could win here. And I always had that dream and that vision. And my dream was to win a national championship, to bring it to Texas Tech, to bring it to West Texas, to Lubbock, and of course, to Texas Tech, because they had never won one. But I love this area. I love the people that are around here. I had to change the mindset. And so that was my number one goal, was to change the mindset. I'm going to quickly tell you a story. In 2000, I took it in 99. I didn't get to recruit that year. Then 2000 came along. Well, we had killed ourselves, the staff, of going in July and getting into homes. And I went into the number ones and the number twos and the number threes. We're going after the big fish. Right. And we had 22 of those top three in their event, of different events, 22 people on a visit one weekend here at Texas Tech in the year 2000. Boy, I rolled out the red carpet. We treated them great. We were going to get them. Guess how many of those are 22, number ones, number twos, or number threes I got? I got none of them.
None? Not even half?
We got none. Wow. I was devastated. I was whatever. But guess what happened? Here's the most important part. They left and went back to their high schools. They went back to the you know, and they'd all been together, and they loved Texas Tech. They said that we thought Texas Tech was podunk. We thought it was sorry. We loved it. We just wish they'd had a better team. But they went back and told their juniors. They told the sophomores. They told people in the community. They told other coaches. We got respect. And so even though I didn't get any of them, I was doing something. I just didn't know it. And we were building something there. So then I got some fours and fives. And then look up, in 2005, we won our first Big 12 championship. We started getting some of those ones and twos. And but now I'll go back to this year's team. I hate to say this, but the year before, we were ranked number one in the country. Right. We were ranked number one in the country going into the indoor. And I think what we just never won big here. And it's a hard thing to do. At Abilene, once I got it going, man, I won seven national championships in a row. You know, we were first or second every year. But I had to change that mindset here, and I had to just continually to get the best people in position year after year. We had to fail at Alabama indoors, and we had to fail. You know, we got fifth, but we were picked to win, and we were picked to win the outdoor the year before. We got fifth. And I think we just learned how to win by failing. And we just didn't, you know, we didn't cry over it. We just learned from it. I told them straight up, you didn't handle the pressure. You did not go into that meet and perform like you've performed during the year. And so that's what happened. Well, when we got after indoors of 19, well, we got to Baylor Invitational in April, and we set the world on fire. We had about five or six number ones in the country that day, from the 400 hurdles, the 100, the 200, the 4x1. We just had some long jump, triple jump. We had some fabulous marks. And I saw it in those kids' eyes. We are good. We know we got a great team. Now let's just go do it. And I felt like they were relaxed the rest of the time and more confident. So I saw it about April before we did it, you know, in June.
Okay. Okay, Ken, that's you're leading right in. You keep leading into what I want to go into. Well, can you tell us about the week of and the atmosphere of the coaches and the student athletes going into the NCAA championships and during the competition itself?
Well, I was so excited because it was, you know, it was at the University of Texas, a team that we always want to beat, and they're in our conference. But it was more than that. It was at the University of Texas, so it was in my home state, and it was where everybody could see us on the biggest stage of track and field. And, man, that week of, I felt like, you know, everybody was healthy. We went into that meet really healthy from the regionals. I didn't even run my best sprinters at the conference meet in two events. I was preparing way out to not overwork anybody. And I think we went in there really fresh. And then it was so hot and humid. It was just unbelievably hard that week of. I don't know if you remember it, but we were about to die. I mean, we're in West Texas. We have dry heat. And in Austin, you got, you know, a lot of moisture. But, you know, I believe that first day is the most important. And that Friday, I told them we got to fill up lanes. And we got to, you know, we did something. Our pole vaulters at personal best, we got on 7th and 8th, but we were thrilled because they went in ranked about 15th or 16th. And then here goes the long jump with Justin Hall, and he gets 4th. And, boy, we filled this 4x1, the 100, the 200, the 400 hurdles, the 800. Here we came rolling. And then we knew we had the discus the next last day along with the finals. And we just felt – I could see the momentum building and the confidence building. And I'll never forget on Friday, Mouse walked over to me and said, "Hey, go win this thing." And, you know, I'm like, "Well, aren't you trying to win it?" But I think he saw we had the best team. I think he would tell you that today. And I thought we did. But it's hard to do. It's hard to win a national championship. And we had to have some growing pains. But that week and from April on, I just saw a different look in my kids' eyes.
Man, that's great. That's great. And I remember that heat. It was blazing out there.
it was unbearable almost.
So when you started coaching this coaching affair, who were some of the coaches that you leaned on or modeled your program after?
Yeah, you won't know any of them. Maybe one. You know, my granddad took me up to the track when I was 6 years old, and I'd never seen a pair of spikes, and my grandparents. He had bought the track team some spikes, and these college runners, one of them was from my hometown, had come back to train over break, and he said, "Hey, jog a lap with me. I'm 6 years old," and he's pulling out these pair of spikes. Man, I died and went to heaven right there that day, and I got hooked. And then I had great Jasper Wilson was my high school coach. Dennis Browles was my high school coach. Two coaches in high school that were just impeccable men. I wanted to be a coach from that point on. And then I went to Abilene Christian and Don Hood, who had to coach it all, who won many national championships there on the men's side. He was the hardest working guy. And I feel like I modeled his work ethic and just what he had to do. So many jobs, so many hats he had to wear. I thank God today for giving me that opportunity at Division II. To not have things and to know how to be innovative and to figure things out. We got to make this work. And it was one of the greatest blessings that I had. But Jasper Wilson, Dennis Browles, and Don Hood, they were my three people that really made a difference for me.
Okay. So when did it click on you to you that you were good at this profession?
That was the toughest question you asked me. But, you know, I guess when we won that first national championship in 1985 with my women, it was such a thrill because, you know, the women had never won one at Abilene either. It was the first year they allowed the triple jump in women and the pole vault in women. And I'd picked me out a 37-foot high school girl triple jumper. And anyway, Ann Foster, and she came in there and won the national championship as a freshman at about 42 feet. I don't know. I just felt like that I had figured out how to win at this level and to how to develop kids those first few years. But that second year was special, and it put us on the road for many more to come.
Wow, wow. Can you give any advice to those up-and-coming coaches on how or what to be aware of or what they should pay close attention to in their quest for making a championship program?
Yeah, you know, one thing that people ask me this all the time, and I tell people this all the time, I'm not a yeller, and I'm not a screamer, and I'm not a cusser, but don't take my kindness for weakness. You know, I try to be myself. I think whatever personality you have, now if it's a mean personality, of course not, but I think people can be tough and the kids know you love them, but be yourself. The main thing is don't be fake. And I think number one, be true to yourself. And like I say, I think that's the most important. And the biggest thing that I've tried to do is to have a mentality that I'm going to swim upstream. I can't tell you how many of the really good coaches out there today, I'm not going to name them, that told me not to take this job at Texas Tech, that it was a sorry job. And so it's like a fish swimming upstream. You know, you can either go upstream to a Texas Tech like I did, which I saw the potential in. I saw the gold mine, I called it. I've told people forever, Lubbock's a gold mine. Are you kidding, Coach? It's flat. It's cotton country. It's oil. It's just that, you know. But I saw, wow, I'm in there with Texas and A&M and Texas Tech, the three big major universities in the state of Texas. It's cheaper to go to Texas Tech than it is A&M or Texas. We had an opportunity to no one to, for me to own West Texas, because I left Abilene Christian. I owned West Texas when I was there. So now I'm at Texas Tech, and I wanted to get the best possible athlete from El Paso to Dallas to, you know, San Antonio. And I just saw it as something that was a gold mine. And so I would say just be true to yourself. Don't be a coach. There's a lot of coaches that know how to swing a whistle, but they don't know how to win day to day. And I think you have to learn to be in the day. Each day is separate, and let the day before go. Stay in the moment with what you're doing. The greatest way to manage a team and to manage your group or to manage anything is one-on-one. Don't get your groups too big, because, you know, you lose that focus with that one-on-one. If you really want to make a difference, you give more one-on-one in your counseling, in your team meetings, and in your individual coaching. Instead of, we're really, yeah, it's so hard for us. We'll be mad at you because you were late to practice, and we get in a team meeting. We just say, I'm tired of everybody being late to practice. And I'm really just talking about that one guy. And what I should have done and what I do is I go to that person and deal with it immediately. Don't let things fester. And I think that's one of the greatest managing. It's managing kids. And I think that's, you know, what you do. Everything we do is measurable. Everything has a timeline, and everyone has to be held accountable.
Wow. Yeah. Great advice there. Great advice. Well, to end, can you state a few things that made you proud of through the development of championship programs, coaches, and student athletes?
Yeah. The most proudest thing I am, I feel that we do a good job of, is developing kids. You know, people ask, you know, you ask, well, how come, you know, what happened in the last few years at Texas Tech? Hey, you know, I had the Jonathan Johnsons in year 2004 that went to the Olympics in the 800. All those guys built on all my great guys. I've got several Olympians. I've got whatever. We just never could put five or six of them together until the last few years. But I think the biggest thing that you get proud of is seeing those kids move on. You know, which is kind of cliche, but the pride that when they came to Texas Tech, we were terrible. And now we're one of the most respected programs in the country. And, you know, winning a national championship, having 9 or 10 Big 12 championships, seeing these people, how they used to look at us, and then how, and the pride of Lubbock, Texas. I mean, we don't have pro teams here. We don't have whatever. If it's basketball or football or track and field, Lubbock is a college town. We're 300,000 people, and we're the show in town. And they were so proud to be the first men's team to win a national championship in this city. And so I'm just so proud that we got that off their back, that, you know, you can't win at Texas Tech. That's a terrible place to go. And now, wow, everyone looks at Texas Tech with a whole different demeanor. So I'm really proud of that, and that I brought that to the community, that I brought that to this university, and to Lubbock, Texas.
Right. Oh man, this is a testament to all you coaches out there. Of you see what it took to win a championship, to build, making a championship, not just to win the championship, but how you made the championship program at both institutions. And I'm hoping that you take this to heart from a championship coach, a pedigree of championships. This is a great testament to what he stands for, and what he stands for is indicative to what his team stands for. It's his vision, his heart, and everything goes in it, and they give the same to him. So this is how you make those championships, and this is why we're doing this, to give that out to you all. And I am so appreciative of you, Coach Kittley, of joining us on this segment of the Making of Champions. And I know that this year is going to be very productive for you. I've seen it. I've watched the recruiting. I know your coaching staff. I know you. And I know that you're not just going to be a selling just for the one.
Well, Tyree, I really am humbled, and I'm very appreciative you gave me this opportunity. I hope it helps somebody. And, you know, we're in such a being coaches, and me being a head coach, but even my assistants, we're in such a position of influence, and we have so much opportunities to do good. And, you know, I just want to encourage everybody as we close, to especially you coaches, is just, man, sell kids that they can do more than they think they can do. Even sell kids that they can do more than you think they can do. And you're going to look up one day and, wow, you've got something special that's happened to you. And that's what's happened to me here. And I am excited about this year. We got a really good group back, both men and women. And I love doing this, and I hope the good Lord blesses me with health and I can keep doing it for a long time.
Thank you again, Coach.
I'll be the last one standing, two hands in the air.